we work with the FBI and being in the cybersecurity field, that those two are fantastic for the organization. So many of you already know me. Some of you are even willing to admit that publicly, but for those of you who don't know, I'm Larry Moore. I've been in the information security field for roughly 18 years out of a total of 30 years in the IT field. I started off as a software developer. I actually started off with NASA, worked at Cape Canaveral for a while until the Challenger disaster, and then I moved down to Boca Raton where I worked on OS2 of all things. So that's how I got here. And eventually I moved over to the security space with AIXML. I've worked in the banking field, mobile payments, a number of things. My specialty is enterprise enterprise risk management, data centers, and mobile payments. And one thing I always enjoy about this is being in Austin. It's, for those of you who are new, Austin is one of the best areas, in my opinion, in the country regarding information security. It's just, you really can't beat it. I think it rivals Silicon Valley. And so I urge all of you to take advantage of the opportunities here, especially if you want to get on with your, you want to move ahead with your career. We are always willing to help. We are always willing to touch base and encourage you to do better with your career. It's just, it's a hobby for us in many cases. So thank you for coming. Now, I've been thinking about this topic for, actually, this has been on my mind for a very long time, even before I got into the information security space, because I grew up as a traditional Catholic. I am Irish Catholic. I'm about as Irish Catholic as it can get. I'm stereotypical. I had aunts and uncles who, they did the typical Irish Catholic things. And so, you get the priests and you get the nuns who are always telling you to always behave yourself and always look out, stay on the straight and narrow, that type of thing. What? Oh, yes. And so growing up, this has been one of the topics on the back of my mind for a very long time. And moving into the information security space, I'm seeing a lot of correlation between the two in more ways than one. So I'd like to show you what I think is, what I have learned really works in monitoring, both in your professional life in the information security field and in your personal life. So let's get started. What is monitoring? The description I have, this is my description up on the screen. See, a lot of people think of monitoring as sitting in front of a screen looking at traffic going by, one way or another, whether it's Wireshark or something else. But in reality, monitoring is more than that. It's obtaining and maintaining full-scale, full real-time knowledge of what is going on in your environment. And I think all of you will agree that the more you know about your environment, your business, your customers, and your data, the more you are able to protect against threats. It's not about stopping 100% accurate or being perfect. That's impossible. You cannot create perfection from imperfection. We will always be imperfect. So the best thing we can do is to know what we are doing and be effective and diligent in protecting our information. So in order to start, before you start what you want to start is to monitoring your environment. A lot of people in a lot of, just about every compliance requirement has monitoring included. Whether it's real-time monitoring your traffic, monitoring your access controls, whatever. It may even be monitoring your physical security through the use of cameras and other devices. So to start off, this goes without saying, the risk assessment. And I'm not going to go into too much specifics about this, but I put this up here for a reason. Many new security professionals, many of us old-timers, well, maybe I'm an old-timer, but everybody, the veterans in the other case, we know what needs to be done in security, but a lot of new security people and a lot of, regular folks, think of security as prevention. You lock your doors to prevent somebody from stealing. You lock your house, preventing somebody from coming in. But in reality, we can't always do that. So when you are looking to monitor something to protect your data, you've got to look at it from one of these five critical processes. Think, for example, as a university. A university, the intention of a university is to promote education, research, communication, and so forth. Okay? the concept of prevention is somewhat harder in a university than, say, a power plant. A power plant, it's much easier to lock things down because that is defined by policy. You don't want outsiders coming in. You have professionals. You want to be able to restrict your environment far more, with far more scrutiny than, say, a university. So if a student does something that's not good but not malicious, he may have been trying an experiment that just got awry and just did something wrong. But you gotta be more careful in the university. Maybe rather than prevention, you gotta focus more on detection and response, for example. A hospital, yes, you wanna prevent things, but more importantly for a hospital is continuous operation, because downtime can put lives in jeopardy. So you've gotta look at it from these five perspectives, not just thinking I'm gonna prevent something, but maybe it's hard for me to prevent, and I can't fight a moving train. Rather, just get out of the way and let it pass. Maybe you have to look at it from some other way. So when you think about monitoring from your risk assessment perspective, think of these five ways, and if prevention is, from the prevention perspective, is difficult, then maybe just look at it from another perspective. And I put in here audits, and anybody who is not auditing their environment and doesn't encourage auditing in their environment, you're not really monitoring, because audits are a great way of making sure that everything is done. I have never performed an audit before where everything came out without issues. There's always had to have been some correction. Accounts always stay dormant, slip through the cracks. There are always people do things, they may not do it maliciously, but they violate policy by doing so because they want to do it quickly and cheaply. So you've got to look at it from this perspective. And then when you have your risk assessment, you need to start thinking about the other requirements and other risks. Now, I'm not gonna focus on the last three. We already know those. I'm gonna just focus on the first two. A lot of security professionals, we all want to save the world. We wanna protect data. We do not like seeing poor processes, poor procedures, poor policies. We wanna fix everything. But what's unfortunate, or fortunate depending upon your perspective, is you've gotta think about the contractual obligations. If your role in your company is only to monitor access controls, and you start going in and looking at traffic real time, you may be saying to yourself, hey, I'm doing it because nobody else is doing a good job. Okay, fine. But you're now putting yourself up for liability. You may be extending yourself too thin. You may, instead of tackling one specific issue, you start taking two, four, six. Pretty soon you're going to spread yourself too thin. So it's hard for us to do sometimes, but sometimes you have to stay on what your contractual obligations are. You may hate it, you may be correct, but you still gotta focus on that, because if you spread yourself too thin, you're gonna be terrible in everything. And that just backfires. And then the second one is compliance. I put that disclaimer up there because I know somebody's gonna say this, that compliance is not security. Agree, we all know that, blah, blah, blah. Yeah, okay, we already understand that. But I put this up here because I sort of squirm when I hear it's just about checking the box. I disagree. Is it checking the box? Yes and no. If your QSA is coming in and doing an audit, and you say you're monitoring the environment, he does have to take your word for it, because his only real action is to sit down with you for the entire year and watch you actually monitoring the traffic for let's say, an hour a day. That's impossible. Let's be realistic. So yes, you can fake a QSA, you can fake a PCI ROC or an AOC, it's possible. But let's say, for example, your company is breached through a zero-day vulnerability. Now PCI auditors are gonna come in, the forensics team is gonna come in. Rather than 1,000 possibilities that the QSA has to consider, they have one specific issue they can now focus on. And let's say they go through and they look through your records and they start looking at your logs. And then, wait a minute, this zero day, he breached the zero day vulnerability, but according to your logs, we can see what's going on. We can see the activity. You signed the AOC, which means the attestation of compliance. You have signed a legal document saying that what you are doing is truthful, even if you lie. If the QSA compliance, the forensics people, look at your records and start saying, we see this, why did you miss this? According to your own records, you say you monitor. We're saying it's jumping right out at us. Why haven't you looked at it? Why haven't you reported it? You now are in a lot of, you're in jeopardy. I mean, you're in a lot of serious trouble because you signed a legal document. So you can't say that it's just checking a box. It's not security, but it's more than checking the box. Now, when we are talking about monitoring, and one of the reasons I like monitoring, I think it's just a cool technology. I love it. If I had it at home, I would set it up and just play around with it. I just love messing around with it. And the big buzzword, what good security presentation is without a buzzword? And that's mine for today. SIEM, or, you know, if you're in the East Coast, SEIM. I don't know, it doesn't matter. It combines two common practices of information and event management, puts them together into one big package, ties them up in a bow, and really, I think monitoring is everything in just about every environment. I think monitoring is really the elephant in the room, which is getting ignored for the most part. I'm not saying nothing else is, but monitoring, when properly applied, really is a great mitigator in protecting your environment. Because one of the things, and I'm sure a lot of people agree with me, has been around with this for a while, is because it provides a number of benefits, and I put data aggregation and correlation. Because if you, for example, are running a small business and you see an IP address coming in from outside of the US, you may say, okay, big deal, we have one IP address. But through aggregation, you may see that IP address coming and coming and coming, and it's getting a little bit more and a little bit more. And over a span of 8 to 12 months, you're seeing it hitting you a lot. Well, wait a minute, now that's just not one time anymore. That may be worth an investigation. Who's it coming from? Why is it happening? Is there any specific reason? And correlation is identifying common attributes. If your data is supposed to go out through server X, or you know, through path X in your network, but instead it's going to path Y, the correlating data is going to tell you that. And you can say, wait a minute, it's not supposed to do that. Why? See, it's correlation and aggregation, which I think are one of the most critical forms of this, because that gives you a big picture as to what's going on. It's not looking at your server, it's looking at your entire network. And then another great object is data for forensic analysis. It's great when the forensics team comes in and they have all that information ready to go. And normalization, which is taking different types of records and making them work together. Now, when you are dealing with your cardinal, when you're dealing with your critical data and you want to monitor, monitoring is great. I remember there was a developer back at IBM, and he was just starting off, and he was like, oh, look at all this work I've done. I have all these numbers. Okay, are these numbers addresses? Are these standard numbers? What are they? He had no idea. Because you've got to know what you're looking for. If you don't know what you're looking for, it's going to be kind of hard to say, there's a breach going on. So I just supplied a few of them, but there's a lot more. Like for example, with cardholder data, credit card numbers go through the Luna algorithm. In other words, they're not randomly assigned numbers. If you look up the Luna algorithm in Google, you'll find out it's using modular arithmetic in order to, it comes up with a specific value. They always do. There's the prefix to the credit card, and then the Luna algorithm is used in order to identify the specific card. That's why whenever you enter your credit card number on a website, it doesn't have to go to a server to say it's invalid. All it does is run the Luna algorithm. It's a very simple algorithm. Social security numbers. The prefix of the social security number is created by the specific state. New York and New Jersey have the highest number security number prefixes. If you looked at my social security number, you knew I was born in New Jersey. So that's easy to tell. And then phone numbers, at least in the old days, now they're being changed, but you'll see a lot of central digits in area codes with a 0 or 1, Austin being one of them. Now that is being changed, but like for example, up to the late 90s, it was either 0 or 1. So if you were to see something like that, so numbers to specific objects have patterns. Your Texas driver's license number has a specific pattern. It may be different than Florida or Kentucky or California, but it has a specific pattern. And then we all know about zip codes. It's not hard to find a zip code. If you see a 5-digit number, chances are you can easy to tell if it's a zip code. And then zip codes do go by region. The New York, New Jersey area all begin with zeros. Florida is 3, Texas is 7. And you can start figuring out if somebody lives in Texas and has a 5 digits of code becoming a 7, that might tell you something. Maybe that is an address, part of an address. So when we are dealing with monitoring, I'm not gonna go into too many specifics because that is up to your business. You have to decide what works in your business, and you have to be able to, one critical factor, and a lot of people make a mistake on this, is in the challenges, it's what I should have put this first, data overload. This is what happened with Target. They were getting swamped with all this information, and pretty soon they were just overwhelmed with it. Just that simple, okay? It's not hard to get overwhelmed. So what you have to do in the case of monitoring is you go to your, this goes back to the risk assessment. You start off with your critical systems first. Where is your critical data residing? Where's your HIPAA data? Where your PCI data residing? Do what you can reasonably do with the work that you have available. Don't try to go for everything. If you have to, start off with the smallest encapsulated system first and then work your way out. Because if you overextend yourself, as I mentioned before, pretty soon you're gonna start getting alerts and you're not gonna be able to do a thing about it. You're getting alert number 70 and you're still on alert number 4. You're gonna get overworked, for example. But if you focus on your critical data, you may be breached. You may be compromised. Like for example, if it's with PCI, it's not whether you're breached, but whether your credit card data is breached. That's a big thing. If a desktop is breached, you have an issue. That is a policy violation. But you're not violating PCI. And then you don't have to deal with the PCI audits. And trust me, you don't want to, if possible. Avoid it. Because they are going to come in, and PCI has enough issues. They want to make sure that they figure out what's wrong with you. They're not going to say, they're going to put their finger at you if possible. So focus on what you really can do. A lot of people complain. A lot of security people complain, well, they should have just done a better job of monitoring. Well, that's easy to say. But if you spread yourself too thin, if you're the security guard of one floor, that's one thing. But if you're the security guard of a complex, and you're walking between building and building, sooner or later, you're just going to go in one building, right out the other, just to keep up with your work. So take that in mind. The reason why I mentioned about the data, the types of data before, is because how can you tell between normal activity and noise? Normal activity and breaches. What is noise? Noise is normal data going on that you're not sure about, that you're trying to figure out, is this a breach? That's why the more, again, go back to the knowledge concept. The more you know, the more you are able to determine which is good versus which is bad. And if you're getting overwhelmed, start off small and go out. Look, I mean, it's better that your firewall be breached and that be compromised than your cardholder data. It's not good, I'll admit that. But if I was forced to make a choice, I'll take the firewall, as long as my cardholder data is safe. Prioritization and budgeting are another issues. We all love infinite budgets, and we all know it doesn't exist. I've worked in companies where there was very little budget, and they relied almost entirely on 3 tools. You just have to accept that. We don't get what we want. It's one of those things that's it's a never appreciated job, and then when something goes wrong, you point the fingers. People point fingers at you, accept it. It's just gonna be like that. I have to say though, it is a great time to be a security professional because there's a lot going on. I'm not saying it's all good, but there's a lot going on. If you're just interested in what, I mean, it's a fascinating time to be in. I mean, it's sort of the Wild West out there. 100 years from now, I'm sure it'll be a lot more organized, it'll be a lot more regulated, that type of thing. But right now, it's just, from a technical perspective, you know, it's just, it's fascinating. So now that we've talked about monitoring in your professional environment, let's talk about a little bit about monitoring in your personal environment, which I have called SYNware rather than malware. What exactly does that mean? Now, I have been thinking, as I mentioned before, this has been on the back of my mind for years, maybe even decades, is when you read the Bible and you think, I mean, okay, for example, how many of you have young children? Young children, or, okay, some of you may have young children to be. it amazes me that things go along until kids start to be 3 to 4, when all of a sudden you start realizing that confectionery and sugar products talk. The chocolate chip cookie made me eat it, Daddy. It was just sitting there, but called me. It's cute. It's nice. You remember that years later when their kids are saying the same thing. But in reality, we are all the sources of sinware. We are. We are the originators. We can blame it. I can blame Austin saying, well, he made me eat that pizza, but he didn't. It's my responsibility. I am the source. If I do something good or something bad, it comes from me. So let's start off with, where does sin originate? Now we can look at how malware originates, and we can go from a variety of sources. It is, again, people that's the ultimate creator. We are the sources of sinware, and it's clear as stated in Matthew 7:15. It does not come from outside, it comes from within. I may be tempted to do something, but I have the ability to resist that temptation. Or if I succumb to it, then I am the one who is guilty. I am the one who created the sin. It is our conscience that serves as an intrusion detection system. Now notice I said IDS, because we are not an IPS. We do not have an IPS. We are incapable of being perfect from sin. Jesus is the only person who is the true IPS, if you want to make that analogy. And the reason why I say this is because Jesus made it clear that he is the way, the truth, and the life, and no one can go to the Father except through him. We only can react to sin and take appropriate action, but it is Jesus himself who saves us from sin. So if you look at that analogy, I think that's really good. And when I was thinking about our internal activities as I was getting into security, this started falling in line. So what happens, I want to go, one of the problems that I see that a lot of people have made about other Christians, for example, and I wanted to put this up here. A lot of Christians themselves say this thing, that we're trying to strive for perfection. Well, yes and no. We're not trying to be perfect, because that's impossible. Even if it was possible for me to be perfect, even if I somehow miraculously made that total perfection, I'm still subject to disease, I'm still subject to death. If I jump off a four-story building, my perfect personality is not going to save me. Gravity's going to have the last word. So we are all imperfect. We cannot be perfect. It is impossible. And a lot of people make the mistake is when they're looking for human leaders to, like human elders to run their church or to lead in a specific issue, we have this tendency, although he's not perfect, he does this and he does that, blah, 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 blah. But look at it this way. Peter essentially was the head of the disciples, or the unelected head of the disciples. He was a hothead and he denied Jesus. Three times, two or three, depending on the book. Paul, as Saul, persecuted Christians. He wanted all of them dead. Now that's about as hateful as you can get. And King David committed adultery. Yet they're revered as honorable people in the Bible. Not because they committed the sin, but because they found redemption through God. If you are trying to look for something perfect, you're never going to find it. Jesus is the only way. So stop trying to push against that moving train. You're not going to win. And we do this even today. We look for the perfect political candidate or the perfect CEO. You're not going to find it. So when you're looking for some sort of leadership, or you're looking for something that helps you to guide, besides Jesus, but you're looking for maybe some person to help guide you make the right choices, there's some sort of argument about what we do in Christianity, and here it is. A lot of people say, judge not and you won't be judged, which it does say. But how can you avoid sin if you cannot judge? if somebody invited me to go to a bar and go looking for women, and said, while my wife and kids were staying home, I don't want to be judgmental, I should go. Or should I say, no, that's wrong, I'm going to go home to my wife and kids. You have to make judgment calls. You have to judge for yourself whether something is proper or something isn't. We don't want to say that these days, but that is a fact. In fact, Jesus commands us to judge in favor of God. You have to make choices in order. Jesus specifically said, if you love me, you will follow my commandments. Well, if you don't, if you follow his commandments, we have the ability not to follow. Well, then how do you do, what is that turning point? To follow versus not to follow. It's called judgment. Or, in reality, it's called discernment. Judging can be based upon anything. I can judge somebody if he's an Aggie fan. And I joke about it. We football fans joke about it. We don't need it. But discernment is not based upon just anything. It's based upon the Bible. It's based upon biblical principles. So what is, I could judge somebody with long hair, pierced earrings, and tattoos all over his body, and I might say, well, he's not really a good person. I knew people who were just like that who were Christian rock artists. And they punk rock, heavy metal, you name it, but they were very much Christian. Okay? Applying discernment requires examining the facts and using the Bible as a guideline. Now, what do I mean by that? Let's say, for example, I go into a butcher and I ask the butcher for a pound of beef. The butcher takes a small pitch, puts it on the wraps it up, and gives it to me. Wait a minute, that's only a few ounces, that's not a pound. Well, the butcher will say, wait, I've been in this business 30 years. It's a pound. I, the butcher, know it. Well, you're going to argue back and forth. In reality, what a good butcher, what a reputable butcher will do is put a slab of beef on a scale. And using the independent system of the United States weights and measure system, he will add a little more until it comes to 1 pound exactly. And you as the customer knew what you wanted. You both agreed to it, you were meeting of the minds, the transaction is complete. The butcher may have been 95% right by putting that slab of meat on the scale, but he knew it needs a little more. We must rely on an independent source for ourselves, the Bible as a guideline. We use standards all the time. ISO is one, NIST. We don't just say, you know what, I don't like the way that's set up. We rely on a specific set of standards. But examine everything carefully, hold fast to which is good, abstain from every form of evil. Abstain. To abstain something means you have to make a decision. And you have, and by the Bible standards, evil is that which opposes God. Now let's go into the judgment case a little bit more, because in your monitoring capabilities, you have to make judgments. Your firewall, it may receive a traffic. Should it accept it or should it reject it? And it based upon specific rules. It may block other some certain forms of traffic based on rules. It's not intelligent, but it is making a decision based upon rules. This is what you probably hear more than anything else when critics face the Bible, when critics mention the Bible. They say, judge not or you will be judged. And when you look at a speck of sawdust in your brother's eye, but pay no attention to the plank in your blind eye. Anybody who criticizes that is wrong in this case. And why? Because that passage is for the reader. You, me, everybody in this passage is for anybody. When you're reading it, it's for you. When I'm reading it, it's for me. What Jesus is telling us in this case is to be your own harshest critic first. Look at yourself as first and foremost, because you are the greatest sinner in your own mind. You need to be viewing yourself with humility, with lowliness, and focus more on your salvation than others. Because it's funny, a lot of people will say this. Notice, later on, Jesus specifically says, by their fruits, meaning actions, you will recognize them. When he's talking about false prophets. Wait a minute, so he just contradicted himself. No, he didn't. Because you need to look at yourself. We as human beings love to criticize others. We love to criticize others. If, for example, if you take another guy, Charlie, and Charlie and I go into the same hardware store, steal the very same hammer for the very same reasons on the very same conditions, I'm gonna make excuses why me stealing the hammer was okay. I had started a business, I didn't afford it, I really need, they're a rich evil company, blah, blah, blah. But I'm gonna criticize Charlie for stealing it. Well, he shouldn't have stolen it. It says so in the Ten Commandments. We put ourselves on pedestals. And Jesus is saying, don't you dare do that. We may float up in a balloon with our own arrogance, with our own self-righteousness, but sooner or later you get high enough in that atmosphere, that balloon will pop and you're gonna fall back to earth mighty quickly. That's what Jesus is telling you. It's not saying that what your brother is doing is wrong, but Jesus is also saying, you better focus on yourself first. You may be committing the greater sin. But Jesus also warns, he is the way, the truth, and the life. If a false prophet comes in, he cannot be a Christian. He cannot be following Jesus, because in the concept of the Son of God, that vacancy has already been taken. And to the best of my knowledge, the person who's occupying that vacancy is perfect in every way. So don't try to, God is not looking for a replacement. God doesn't need a backup. He's fine with what he has. So what do we mean by our own arrogance? What, our own pride? This is a great parable of this. The parable of the Pharisee and the tax collector in Luke. Two people are praying in the temple. The Pharisee is the greatest guy on the face of the planet. He is good, he is nice, he does all these wonderful things, blah, blah, blah. Okay? And the tax collector, now remember, in those times, tax collectors were the dregs of society. They were considered traitors. They were considered aligned with the Roman people. And a lot of tax collectors cheated. They did a bunch of things wrong. What this tax collector is, be merciful to me, a sinner. And Jesus is saying the tax collector is justified, but not the Pharisee. Why? Because the tax collector, being poor in spirit, means that you have nothing to offer to God to atone for our sins. We cannot do it. You don't go to heaven, give God $1,000 and say, let me in the book. You know, it doesn't work like that. You have to go through by aligning yourself with Jesus. He acknowledges his imperfections. He approaches it that he knows what his parts are. And as a monitoring, he is fully aware of what he is doing. He's fully aware of his weaknesses. He is fully aware of what is going on. He is fully aware of how to approach God to ask for mercy, unlike the Pharisee. So in discernment, judge by righteousness, not by appearances. You'll notice it's judged by actions, not by mere appearances. Don't just judge someone because you don't like the way they look. But if somebody acts inappropriately and does things inappropriately, refrain from that or try to turn them away from his actions. And most of all, be the truth in your heart. If you find a brother who is or a sister who is sinning, bring another person in, confront him with it, and remind that person of their faults. Do not take it to the church. Jesus is commanding us to do this. In fact, there are books in the Bible that titled Judges. We have a book called Judges. Solomon was a judge. He was a very wise judge. And more examples on this. The woman who committed adultery. Neither do I condemn you, but avoid this sin from now on. Luke, Zacchaeus, the small guy that climbed the tree. Look, Lord, here now I give half my possessions and I'll repay anybody I cheated. And then I like this one. This was where the woman dried his feet with her hair. She put a little oil and water. Jesus gave a parable. Simon the Pharisee replied from that parable. I suppose who had the biggest debts forgiven? You have judged correctly, Jesus said. But then later when Simon said, that woman, she should not have done that, Jesus criticized her because she shown real forgiveness. So what do you base your, what is your anti-sinware rules? Love. And the seven virtues that derive from love. I'm not going to go into specifics. The Bible has clear. These are what you want your internal deduction systems to permit this activity to flow out from you. Patience, kindness, humility, chastity. And you want to block these seven deadly sins. Pride, sloth, you know what? I'm suffer from gluttony. I make no pretense about it. I should eat less. I don't. I gotta lose weight. I don't blame anybody else for it. Sloth, God bless his work. That's why you love your God with your heart, soul, and mind. God rewards those who use their mind for good. A lot of people forget about that. When you learn to help others, you are using. Why do you think so many universities were founded by Christians? Because they took that as a translation to improve the mind. Now, I'm going to focus on one more thing and then I'm done. And I know I'm limited on time. A lot of people say, you know what, I love God. I don't have to do anything else. I don't have to go to church. I don't have to read the Bible. I don't have to study scripture. And this is what really started my quest, if you will. Because people say, you know what, if you really do love God, why do you have to go to church? Why do you have to read? You already know. If I were to take, you know this experiment. I give you a secret. I whisper something to you. You whisper to him, and so on and so forth. It's going to be different at the end than what it was. We all know that. As I mentioned before in the butcher example, we can guess what a pound might be, but it's based on the U.S. weights and standards measured by. We rely on an accurate number. If you remember the book on Animal Farm, it's a great book, by the way, if you've never read it. The animals took over the farm, kicking out Farmer Jones, and created these rules. One of them being no animal shall harm another. The pigs took over. They became, they just became bossy. And then sooner or later, no animal shall harm another without cause. They wanted to change the rules for their behavior. If we do not follow the Bible, we do not strive to become closer to God, pretty soon thou shalt not steal will be thou shalt not steal unless it's an evil corporation or that person steals from others. We will change it to meet our needs. By studying the Bible and by going to church, however you want to call it, I'm not going to go into specifics about it, but you must, just as we learn from a standard that's been designed and is standard, standardized and fixed, we know as to what to do. We can identify, like, for example, weights, measures, etc. We know a foot is a foot, a meter is a meter. And the Bible says, thou shalt not steal. Well, you can pretend you don't, but reading the Bible will just come back at you and come back at you and come back at you. By failing to follow the Bible, by actually intentionally studying it and learning more about it, you cannot say you love God. Because what you're doing is you're going to twist whatever you want to do to meet your needs rather than God's needs. Sooner or later, it doesn't become about God, it becomes about you. And you might say, well, why do I have to go to church? You go to church because you worship in a congregation with other people and you listen to the gospel. However you do it, whatever denomination, that doesn't matter. The important thing is that you follow a separate standard and it tells you, and it might even strike at your heart and you may want to deny it, but you can't, it's firm, it's there. You can try to, but you can't deny it. So if you want to monitor correctly, you have to go to the source. You cannot rely on yourself because you will change it to meet your needs. And sin will continue to corrupt you and destroy you. And you can pretend all you want. You can lie to yourself. You cannot lie to God. So in conclusion, how many minutes do I have?
You did good. You have 9 minutes.
Oh, nine, okay. So rather, I'm going to just continue on this in a little bit more. But because I remember in high school, a lot of people would say, I don't have to go to church. You know what? I already know all this stuff. Blah, 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 blah. And I knew some people who got into a little bit of trouble. Maybe not with the law, but they got involved with drugs and so forth. Wait a minute, if you love God, how can you say you love God but you don't follow his commandments? Pretty soon it's, I love God, but only if God just lets me do what I want. This is why this really strikes to me personally. Because I know I'm a sinner. I'm a glutton. I mean, I don't pretend that. And I shouldn't be, but I am. But I have to at least keep trying to improve myself. And a lot of people make this mistake. They think, I'll go at Easter and I'll go at Christmas and I'm done. You need to start becoming routinely. If you spend more time on your business, on your security, your career, you take a class, you read some, you read manuscripts, you participate in a board somewhere, but you don't spend enough time on the Bible, you're going to save your career, but you're going to destroy yourself. I look at it this way. What do you have to do to achieve physical fitness? Hard work, dedication, and sacrifice. Eating cupcakes doesn't help you build an Arnold Schwarzenegger body. What do you have to do to get great mental fitness? Education, hard work, dedication, and sacrifice. Watching the Simpsons marathon is not going to help you with that physics test coming up. What do you do about spiritual fitness? Do I need to repeat the three requirements? Hard work, reading, studying, interacting with others, and learning from your own mistakes. Dedication, being dedicated to the scripture. And sacrifice from sin. Those who say that they don't have, I know what I have to do. My doctor goes into labor whenever I see him. And he's right. I used to exercise a lot. And I let myself go. But I've got to bounce back, and that's what I've got to do. Hard work, dedication, and sacrifice. And that's what you have to do if you want to become closer to God. You cannot do it any other way. So think about that. And nobody's saying that you have to do X, Y, and Z. But a lot of people will say, you know what? I want to be closer to God, but it's got to be on my terms, and it's got to be when I feel like it, and so on and so forth. I mean, for goodness sakes, you've got Bibles on these things these days. You can read for 30 seconds in the parking lot. You can get apps like this nowadays. So just remember that. You don't have to carry a big volume of Bible anymore like you did in the old days. So always remember that. And sometimes, being with other people, you can learn about your own sin. You can find out that maybe if you did something wrong and you correct it, you might find yourself closer to your family, your spouse, your friends, your family. Is your sin that important to destroy? Think about it that way. And many people here, they'll be willing, happy to talk to you in private to help you steer away from that. So to conclude, security comes in many forms. Choose yours wisely, whether you want prevention or detection or mitigation. Understand your data. I think that's very important. If you don't know what you're monitoring, the attack could be going on and you have no clue. I used to program in the PostScript language, for example, and PostScript is a stack-based language. And sometimes, we actually did this once, you could see the PostScript data going back and forth to the computer just to see how it works. It was fascinating to watch. That sort of got me. It was one of the reasons why I got into monitoring. It's how the printer interacts. I mean, printers are computers too. If you have to protect your Internet of Things, for example, you've got to look that up as well. You've got to consider that. If you want to ever meet me, go to Home Depot. I'm always there. I'm playing around with one of the Internet of Things they have there. I'm always in the electronics section. I love that place. I used to work there too. An aggregation and correlation of your friends. Try to obtain that. Try to get that, because I think that really shows you the big picture. In Christ's perspective, judge righteously, discernment based upon the Holy Scripture, anti-sinware. Be the anti-sinware detector that all Christians should be. Be your own strictest critic. I'm not saying help others, but remember, look at the plank in your own eye and judge righteously. Judge on actions. And help those who suffer from sin to turn away from sin. We don't condemn, we help. Let's help others. I love helping people. I don't know, I just get such a, it's like an endorphin in my brain goes off when I help people get jobs. I really do, or get into the security field. It's an obsession with me. I love it. I work with the Launchpad Job Club. Anybody who needs a job, if I can find it, I will. I help them. It's just fascinating. So think about it that way. And whatever you decide to do, just remember that Jesus is the only intrusion prevention system. If you really want to save your life, he is the only way. Don't try to do it yourself. You're not going to. Don't try this at home, in other words. Anyway, thank you very much. questions if there's.
Yeah, this is great.
Yes, sir.
A good 15 minutes plus for questions. One quick question to start. Say you run into somebody and you say, I don't understand this gospel thing. You know, what is the gospel specifically? We use that word a lot. I know you've mentioned it in different ways here, but so you've got a couple of minutes to tell someone what the gospel is. What would you say?
What has worked for me, and this may be a bit odd, I love talking about the gospel from the historical perspective and from the scientific perspective. For example, I know somebody who right now, and he's going through a lot of trouble. If I were to go in and start talking and start evangelizing with him and start going into that, you know, as the stereotypical evangelist, I know he would just walk away because he's not quite ready for it. So rather than just focusing on that, I focus on the seven virtues, helping him improve one little virtue at a time, okay? Helping him a little bit more with being more humble and being a little bit more honest and being a little less proud, okay? You've got to judge it based upon the individual, and it's hard to say, but it's always worked for me. I look at God's will through physics. To me, the concept, for example, of an airplane flying, we walk through air with no effort, but yet, when properly applied, aerodynamic force has the power to lift a 2-ton airplane. I'm just boggled by that. It's incredible. And I love talking about it from a scientific perspective. So when people are asking about the gospel, I try it from more of a scientific perspective or more of an objectional perspective rather than a specific evangel. Because in trying to get somebody to convert, if their shields go up, and this was in the security and social engineer podcast, the most recent one, if their shields go up and they become defensive, they're going to get turned off. But if you try to look at it from more of their perspective, at least get something that they're interested in, their shields go down, they open up more, you open, ask more open-ended questions, and before you know it, the foot's in the door. And once their foot's in the door, then a little bit more. They're the second foot in the door.
So say they're ready.
Yeah.
All right, what is it? What
would you say? The gospel is the testament of Jesus Christ while on earth to talk, to get people to follow God and his commandments.
I guess I would say it a little differently. Say it's the good news that Jesus Christ came and died to mitigate our
sins.
That's
perfect. That's even better than I thought. You know what? If you ever thought about this, Jesus became the Lamb. Why is Jesus called the Lamb of God? Because at that time, the Lamb was a sacrifice. Jesus sacrificed himself. Crucifixion was one of the most painful ways to die in those days. Jesus became the Lamb of God. And by you obviously you're not going to sacrifice yourself on the cross. So what you do is you believe in him, you believe in what he did by dying on the cross. Every spring, just before Easter, I always watch The Passion of the Christ. That's on my every single year. I never get tired of it. Because it really it's if you've probably seen the movie, I never get tired. It's a reminder.
There's a new movie coming out that takes it from the perspective of the Roman soldier. And I'm looking forward to seeing that.
There's actually a great movie out called The Rogue. Well, not out, but it's been Richard Burton. And he's the soldier. He plays a soldier who got Jesus' cloak when he was on the cross. And from that on, he became a Christian, even to a point where he was going to be, at the end of the movie, he's going to be executed for being a Christian. His conversion, he was like a Roman captain. Yeah. And then he just changed it, and it was sort of like an internal violent. It wasn't just, oh, I'm a Christian. No, it was like an internal violent change, for lack of a better term. He's going through all these issues and so on and so forth. It's a really great movie.
Mm-hmm. Hey, Larry, one thing you mentioned, talking to the guy who's having trouble about the virtues and the problem is we know that the Old Testament basically identified the law, mm-hmm. and the law was to identify that we are not capable of fulfilling it, so we have to have a Savior.
Right.
And so the same thing, if you have someone who does not recognize the source of salvation, then the rules, if you will,
are irrelevant.
They don't help except right. to identify that it's outside of his capability.
And I think part of the problem is because a lot of people misperceive what, who Christians are like. And this is why I mentioned about the planking you're on. When I get criticized a lot. I used to work right across the street from Whole Foods and Lamar, which is Nut Job Central of the universe, okay? And I get people on all sorts of things. And I would try to evangelize with them, and that never worked. That just never worked. They would shut down. They'd go across. People used to walk across the street when I would go to lunch at Whole Foods. I'm serious. So I tried a different approach where I tried to ask them just open-ended questions, and they couldn't argue with it. And I said, well, wait a minute. Are you so sure that maybe there's something else? And I actually had people say, you know what? You may be right. Now, they may have completely lied. I don't know. But I found I had a better chance through asking open-ended questions to get them to see it. You're right. Without Jesus, there's nothing else. But sometimes it's not in a conversion like that. It may take a month. It may take a year. It may take a decade. But you've got to start converting. People are going to have their opinions. And they're going to keep their opinions. And if you don't look at it, listen to the Social Engineering podcast. It's a great thing about how to get people to see more on your side and how the speaker is trying to see more on other people's side. It's a great podcast. And he does this. He tries to draw them in with interesting questions about them. And when people start doing that and then they start seeing that, see, I'm not much of an evangelist. I am not saying, standing on street corners yelling about Jesus. I'm just not comfortable with that. But I will talk from a logical perspective and draw people in that way, because that is something that I have found has worked much better for me. Because I am a very logical, analytical person. I love science. I love the concept of physics and how things work in the universe. It's just fascinating to me. And so I try to work through that. And then I also try to do it through my actions. For those of you who know me, you know I'm a royal pain in the backside. And that's what my friends say. You can see what people don't like me say. But in reality, I try to always remember, because I mentioned pride and humility a lot, because I know if I'm not careful, I can eventually be proud. I don't want to do that. I make a lot of jokes about myself. Self-deprecating humor, to me, keeps me right down at that level. Because that just, to me, I am a good security expert. Am I God's gift to the security world? No. There's a lot of people who are better at certain aspects than me. I would rather be wrong and learn something new than pretend to be right just because my ego refuses to permit it. And people like Werner are highly intelligent, and Austin and so forth, and if I'm wrong, if they teach me something new, I look at it from the point, you know what, I gained something. I don't ever want to be arrogant. I want to remain humble to a certain point, meaning that I want to say I'm good, because if not, you can outdo yourself, make yourself look bad. But I want to make myself where I'm good. I can qualify. I'm qualified, but I don't want to overdo that, because I can make myself out to look worse than I really am.
Hey, Larry. One of the things interesting you mentioned the correlation. And one of the problems we have is that if we don't have a good time standard, if we're not consistent in time throughout our organization, then correlation is extremely difficult. And recently that was used against us, because the open ports for NTP was an attack vector. Mm-hmm. And so, it's getting to the point we need to have that internal clock. And that's, I think, a good analogy for the spirit within us giving us an internal standard that we can keep things in order paying attention to the spirit.
You mentioned something else. You're talking about the time standard. I've seen it before where some companies had one time standard over here and another time standard over there. And what you've got to do is your entire life has got to be focused in the spirit, not just a part of it. Just like you want to focus the same time standard everywhere, so that if you're looking at a tax coming over here and you're using a universal time, and your tax over here and it's universal time, you're able to correlate it. You've got Pacific and Eastern, you've got translation, you've got a whole mess of stuff. There was I was doing an audit of the data center, and we were reviewing the time codes on their monitors, and their monitors were like 15 to 20 minutes off. One was like 2 o'clock here, one was 2:15 here. Now imagine if somebody, you see somebody walking here, and he walks here, which is like 30 seconds later, but you're seeing 15 minutes later, now that's giving you the wrong idea. Well, he stopped for some reason.
Or 15 minutes earlier.
Yeah. Yeah, something like that.
Came in here, got there 50 minutes before it doesn't work.
And for those of you who do work on data centers, they will flag you for that. If your time codes do not meet or match, you get flagged for that.
Yeah.
But just be aware, if you have to do an audit of a data center, check that out. You get slapped on the wrist for that a few times.
Any other questions or comments?
One other thing, and this is a little bit self-serving, but the whole monitoring thing, if you look at the time from compromise to detecting or being told by the FBI that you've been compromised, it's as long as, the average at one point was like 400 days. They're very long time frames. There was a company that literally was owned for 4 or 5 years, went out of business because everybody else knew what they were bidding. And so you have to be careful about, 24/7 monitoring, which is one of the things SecureWorks does. You don't let your guard down, but that's an expensive process. So outsourcing it might make sense.
Oh, Larry, could you put your first SIM slide up? I wanted to guess.
My first SIM? Hang on.
That was some good stuff.
You mean the SIMware?
The first one that explained that had the word SIE in the word.
Oh, okay. Hang on for a second. Let me get that.
Yeah, while I was doing that, the other thing is, we get data, overwhelmed with data, and taking, data and parsing it into something that is actionable or is illuminates our decisions, and that's, kind of the whole metrics arena, where we, instead of saying we got, 500 bugs per 1,000 lines of code, or, 500 bugs, we compare it to the amount of code that's being dealt with. And so the larger the code, a strict number is not as meaningful.
I'm sorry, it says it's cooling, so
okay.
I'm sorry. But this, I'll make it available, anybody wants it.
Yeah, we post the slides at acronyms.org. Yeah.
And like I said, I love talking shop with anybody, so.
All right, well, cool. Well, we've got about 5 minutes, so I'll just close. I should have mentioned at the beginning, there's Bibles at the back. If you don't have one, free to take, just grab one. And I just want to thank you, Larry, for coming. We appreciate it.
Thank you all.
And 5 minutes of your life back, so enjoy.